now to our interview segment. My guest, Boma Ozobia, is a cross-border solicitor, advocate, and ADR specialist, among other things. We had a chat about the president's appointment, corruption, and issues of the Nigerian bar. The president has been criticized lately for some lopsided appointments that he has made. And ahead of the nomination of ministers and other cabinet members, what advice would you give to him, especially with regards to female inclusion and sensitivity?
One of the key things I would say is APC government, led by the current president, were elected by Nigerians on the basis of a manifesto. One of the key aspects of that manifesto was the gender equality they promised by various means, mostly legislative. They will make sure women have equal rights with men in terms of property, inheritance rights. I know the Supreme Court has dealt with that under the various rulings where they say anything that doesn't comply with our constitution in terms of equality is not acceptable and therefore cannot stand. But it can bear reinforcement by positive legislation to say women have equal property rights and so on. They have aspects of their manifesto and promises to us Nigerians where they talked about the fact that violence against women would be dealt with, the right of the girl child would be protected, and certainly they would proceed with the 35% representation and possibly more, because if you're aiming to achieve parity, it wouldn't be 35%, it would be 50%. So on that basis, I can't say that from a gender perspective that I'm very impressed with the appointments to date. I mean, I understand that the president is appointing his immediate inner circle and the team that has to work with him, mostly effectively on a personal basis. Even then, my question would be, don't you have any trusted friends who are female? You know, and don't you have anybody in your inner circle who can fit into that position and still help to meet the gender representation that you promised? Okay, perhaps not. And if
there's
not,
there's been one though, the acting INEC chairman.
One out of how many? So we had, I think it was the 27th of August, we had four appointments, all men. There should have been at least one woman. It's early enough to redress this, which is why for me, this is the time for us as women to be flagging this up and saying you are the president of all of us. You belong to everybody and you belong to nobody. And therefore you belong to us women as much as you belong to the men. And you have to remember us and remember that we are capable and we want to serve.
The 2015 NBA conference was recently concluded in Abuja, the FCT. Now, the president was at that conference, and one of the things he said was that lawyers should key into his anti-graft war. He specifically advised lawyers not to sacrifice the integrity of the country's legal system in a bid to cover the misdeeds of their clients, no matter how lucrative the brief may be. Now, this advice of the president, how much of a danger is it really?
Well, what I have to say firstly is we're all Nigerians. Graft hurts us all. And to that extent, it's in our collective interest to ensure that where we see it and whatever we can do to stop it, we must. As lawyers, we are professional advisors and we have professional duties towards our clients, which is outlined in our Legal Practitioners Act, Ethical Code, and so on. And one of the primary duties, which is why we're called advocates, is that we take the case as presented to us by our client, and then we put it to the court as best we can within the ambits of the law. To that extent, I don't think it allows us much leeway for moral judgments. Certainly from a practitioner's perspective, it's not our place to make that judgment call as to whether the individual is guilty or not guilty. That is for the judge. Having said that, there are certain things that lawyers can do which can be classified as unethical. So for instance, where you know and the individual has indeed, the evidence is overwhelming that the likelihood of that individual being guilty is high. It's not, in my view, ethical to then begin to use the inefficiencies of the system to delay the cause of justice. Because you remember, we have a dual role to play. Not only are we advocates, we are also officers of the court. Yes, and therefore, we owe a duty to the court as well. And I think in a lot of the cases where, which perhaps led to the president's call to us as a profession, it may have been that lawyers forget that they have that dual role to play.
Talking about the anti-graft war, though, where do you stand? There's been so much talk, so much debate about whether we should have specialized courts or specialized judges. And even the civil society has recently come out to say that perhaps we should have death penalty for corrupt people that are convicted of corruption. Where do you stand on this?
From a Nigerian perspective, I am totally with the civil society people who say kill corrupt people, because corruption kills. I mean, corruption is why our children are not vaccinated. Corruption is why we're dying on our roads in Nigeria. Corruption is why our planes are falling out of the sky. Corruption is why we do not have sufficient, you know, we don't have clean water. We don't have the basic infrastructure. So to that extent, I feel as passionately as everybody else does. But speaking from the perspective of a lawyer, then I would say that, yes, the justice system could move a lot quicker. And we say justice delayed is justice denied. That's even more so with the corruption cases. And the specialized courts, in my view, will certainly aid the speedy dispensation of justice. And this is not my subjective view alone. There is empirical evidence. There's more than sufficient statistics from other Commonwealth countries where this has been implemented to show that it has sped things up. It has meant that more cases are dealt with quicker. And justice is dispensed that much more efficiently. Now, how do we achieve this? It is, in my view again, and like I said, not my subjective view alone. I have seen it working in Uganda. It works in Ghana. It works in, certainly in England, where we got this system from. And it is simply an administrative function of the head of the court. In this case, the Chief Justice of the Federation or the President of the Court of Appeal. And it's as simple as assigning cases to specific judges, courts 9 to 10. So court 9 to 10, you will deal with EFCC and corruption cases, full stop. 8 to 7, you will deal with this. And all those cases, no one can interfere with the ability to do that. And then you give them specialist training and all of the supporting staff, and you find that it moves things along very quickly.
Let's end with issues of the bar. One of the fallouts of the 2015 conference was the introduction of e-voting to allow for everyone to vote in future elections. Do you think that Nigerian lawyers are ready for that?
In my view, I would say that we certainly are, and it's about time. If we have a database of all the Nigerian lawyers, which we apparently do, then it's a simple next step to put in place a mechanism to enable us vote from our desks wherever we are. It's not rocket science. Again, it's been done elsewhere, and I don't see why, you know, unable to do that here. It certainly will improve the system tremendously, because it will mean that those who wish to serve us will not have to go to such great expense and personal sacrifice in order to get elected.
Traveling around.
I mean, and spending so much money on all of that and so on. That limits our choice. That also in so many ways. So yes, this is certainly an improvement on the system, and I believe we can do it.
So with this introduction of e-voting, do you think that the time has come for lawyers to jettison this idea of zoning elective positions?
This zoning of offices came from a historic thing. I have my view on this zoning business and federal character and all of these things, because I understand that the motive is right. It is about getting fair representation from across the country. But the way it is implemented invariably leads to a lack of, you know, those merits being sacrificed on the altar of fair representation. I think that we can achieve both. I think that we can do that by jettisoning all of this zoning and federal character business. I think it's time we recognize that we're all Nigerians and deal with ourselves on that basis. If the best 10, our first 11, all happen to come from the Etiosa local government in Lagos State, so be it.
Let's play up merit.
It is time. You know, we don't have time for this. We have to put our best foot forward and get our country where it has to be, sooner rather than later.
That is our program for today. You can find these and past episodes on our YouTube channel. Please also send any feedback via any of our social media handles. I am Shola Shieli. Thank you for watching.